Now we're going to start our little journey. 2 Peter. And before I start, let me just tell you this. We've got some excellent speakers here today, and I'm not going to get into the point of belaboring things. We've got the people here who can handle all those things. But what I'm doing more today is a general perspective and over generalizations and giving a little bit of background, a little bit of future, too, about what we're talking about, the final atonement. And I guess I could have, instead of the message, I mean, type that I did, and that type says, and we'll see it here as we read verse 19, 20, and 21 in 2 Peter chapter 2. Yes. It says, we have also a more sure word of prophecy. Prophecy. What it's all about. Let's turn for a minute. Keep your finger there, but let's turn to Revelation chapter 12. I'm not going to tell you anything that you don't already know. I'm going to try to tell it in a little different way. But anyway, verse 17. And the dragon was wroth with the woman and went to make war with the remnant of her seed, which keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus Christ. What is that testimony? And what is that? Mm-hmm. And what word did we just use? Mm-hmm. We have also a more, we have also a more sure word of prophecy. So that is the connection. And you say, well, what does that have to do with what the theme of this, this camp meeting is all about? What relevance does the final atonement have without prophecy? It's the reason and the motivation for it. From the beginning and from Adam and Eve's and their education, spiritual education process, it started there. It began there. And as we see here now, down through the annals of time, it ends there. It ends with prophecy. That is what the final atonement, as I've grasped it, is all about. It's all about fulfilling prophecy. And that is what it's doing. I started to title it, as I said, and then what? Well, what happens after, in a sense, the final atonement? What's next? What's next gives you the implication of what the final atonement is really all about. It's about bringing the next thing in after the final atonement. What happens after the final atonement? We talked about that many times, right? Down through life. What happens? Mm-hmm. The second coming. So the final atonement is to set the stage for what? The greatest event in human history. Why? I'm going to talk to you about three different things today. And I don't know whether you've ever thought about it or not. But I'm going to talk today about restoration. Because the final atonement is about restoration. I'm going to try to talk to you about redemption. Because the final atonement is about being redeemed. Who and what? And who does the redeem? I think about what it says in John. John 5:39. And what does it tell us to do? Everybody don't have to go running to your Bibles. Y'all know it already. Search the scriptures. I remember this, although my dear honor is going on since I, when I was that high. That was one of her favorite scriptures to quote. And I said, why does she keep saying that? And I thank God I have lived the day that even though she's far gone on, you know, she's gone on, she's asleep. But I remember what she said. Search the scriptures, for in them you think you have eternal life. And they are they which testify of me. What is the final atonement about? Jesus and his work of restoration, redemption, and one more word, regeneration. Regeneration. Does it not tell us in the scriptures that the day is coming when corruption will not be what? Corruption and more. What will it be? Incorruption. There's a day coming when mortality will no longer be. I told you, you've been over these words many times, but I'm trying to get you to see it in a little bit different context. So, mortality will be no longer. Then what will be?
Immortal.
And so the final step before all of this happens is what? Is to make sure that before we have it, we have to be ready for it, right?
Yeah,
what makes us ready for it? The what?
Restoration.
What makes us ready for the restoration and the regeneration?
Redemption.
Okay. But before we are ready for it or prepared to receive it, we have to have an atonement. What is the atonement? Who can give me a very brief?
At one.
Okay. At one with who? At one with Christ, or at one with our God. That's what this is all about, to bring on what we really need. It's telling us it's time to go back home. Where did we come from? Who brought us into being? And why? Who created us?
God.
God. And when he created us, he did it in a very special way that is not spoken of for anyone else in the universe. He said he created us in whose image?
His
image. So what are we really being doing here as we were talking about and prioritizing the final atonement? What are we really talking about? Going back home, being put back into the state, the mind, and the condition in all ways that we once were.
Recreation.
Hmm?
Recreation.
Yes, that's what we're talking about. We're talking about being restored. How is restoration going to take place?
Recreation.
If we aren't ready for it. And how are we going to get ready for it? The final atonement. And in fact, this way, we don't really get ready for it. What we're doing is preparing to receive it. Because we are doing the work.
Amen.
He is.
That's right.
We're not doing the work. We're being redeemed. But we aren't doing the redeeming. Who is?
He is.
Jesus.
Jesus is doing the redeeming. And the renewal and the regeneration. And we get back to that verse. What? Search the scriptures. For in them you think you have eternal life. And they are they which testify of me. Who is the very essence of prophecy?
Christ.
Without Christ, there is no need for what?
Redemption.
There is no need for prophecy. There is no need for redemption. There is no need for restoration. Without Christ. So the centerpiece of what? Of being at one, the final atonement, is without question who?
Christ.
Not the fact that you have doubts, but people were thinking about it and wondering about it a little bit. The essence of the final atonement is the one who was doing it and who he's doing it for. He needs no atonement. Well, if he needs no atonement, why does he do it?
Because
we need it. Y'all like my new style? I know that some of you were kind of braced in there waiting for the storm to lash out. So some of you have never seen or heard of me before. You might talk to them. They'll give you a little bit of background.
And some people here were like bracing, you know, like when you take off an airplane or something. So they're just bracing and saying, wait till we get hit. Hopefully you won't get hit. Now, and let's go back to 2 Peter chapter 2, beginning with verse 19. We have also a more sure word of prophecy. Whereunto you... We have also a more sure word of prophecy, whereunto ye do well that ye take heed, as unto a light that shineth in a dark place. Why would you shine a light in a dark place?
So you can see.
Mm-hmm. Or another way to say it is what? Envision. Envision. See, all things are not about physical structures, like put it in a closet or something like it. So let's see it from the spiritual context. What is putting a light on a dark place?
Prophecy.
Exactly. And from prophecy, we get atonement. And so through the revealing of the atonement of Jesus Christ for us, darkness is doing what? It's becoming light more and more and more. Now let's finish it. As unto a light that shineth in a dark place. That's what the atonement is all about. It's a light putting an understanding on a spiritually dark place. What happened? Why it happened? How did it happen? And why did it turn out the way it did? Who's in trouble?
We are.
Why are we in trouble?
Exercise of free choice in a negative direction.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. We got ourselves what? In it. But can we get ourselves out of it?
No.
Can sin die for itself?
No.
It can die, but it can't die for itself. It will die.
Amen.
But the next part says, until the day dawn. What day? We see a day every day that we live. But this day is like what? No other day. In the completion and the fulfillment of the atonement, what's going to happen? We as humanity will be ready for something we have never been ready for since sin came into the world. It says what? And until the day dawn, in other words, come out of what? What happens at dawn that's the most significant thing?
Darkness is over.
Mm-hmm. I remember my father when I was this high telling me sometimes when I'd get down and discouraged and disheartened, he says, son, it's always darkest just before the dawn. What's raging now? Who knows that he has but a short time? Mm-hmm. And what is his mission? I'm not going to get into world events, but just a little bit here. What's going on in parallel levels there? What I'm surprised that it hasn't been even worse. And what I'm most surprised at, that it hasn't struck at the very core of the thing that he hates the worst. His people worshiping God in truth.
We're not ready for it.
And what should we be doing? Getting ready. Mm-hmm. Getting ready. You ever heard that expression, are we there yet? We're never going to get there until we prepare to get there. What did he say, one of the prime commissions? What did he tell all of us? Lay aside.
Every weight.
Anybody feeling heavy? We have to lay aside every weight. Not only what we think is weight, but we have to lay aside and let it be known and made aware to us what we may not understand and truly think of. We can look and see at other people and say, how come they can't get that? So you tell me this, now it's going to get a little bit heavy. Why come we don't get it? I don't want you to answer it now. I want you to go home or wherever to your places of meditation, whatever, thinking, why come we don't get it? Not so much about what we have done, but how much more is there to do that is not getting done because we don't grasp it, and we still trying to shine a light by the grace of God into what? A mighty dark place. Y'all getting me? Because the expression says, you feel me. You understand what I'm saying. You understand who I'm saying it about. What did the Word of God say about examination?
Examine yourself.
He says, let a man who? Examine himself. And I say it in this context. What we say about others, what we speak about others is true. But what does that have to do with my salvation and yours? Hopefully, I didn't come to tell you what you wanted to hear. I came to tell you what we need to hear.
Amen.
Now, and the day star arise in your hearts. That's what I'm talking about right here. Has the day star arisen in our hearts? It doesn't matter who else's heart it is or isn't in or what degree or whatever, but has the day star arisen in your heart and my heart? Amen. When you're up there preaching, it don't mean that the day star has arisen in my heart. Did not he say, when I have preached to others, yet my, what? My own soul could be lost. So let's go on to verse 20. Knowing this first, that no prophecy of the scripture is what? Is of any private temptation. I've heard so many times in my life people saying, I can't get it. The first rule I can't get it is you got to want to get it. And want it beyond what you think is enough effort. You shall find me when? With what?
All.
Most?
All.
And what? When there is an urgency that whoever or whatever never becomes more important. Did not he tell us, he that will not about mother and father and about forsaking them, if you are not ready to forsake mother, father, child, or whatever else, you weren't ready.
That's right.
Yes, we love them, and we ought to love them. But who is first?
Yes.
And what is first? Getting ready for the kingdom to come. We want that what? We want the kingdom to come. How many in here want the kingdom to come?
Amen.
Don't you answer this question out loud. How many are ready? How many think you're ready? Don't answer this question out loud. Knowing this first, that no prophecy of the scripture is of any private interpretation. If we want to know, we can know. No excuses, no rationalizations, no explanations. I tried to stay away as long as I could have, but yes, I'm turned into a bad little man again. Verse 21, for the prophecy came not in what? Old time by what? The will of man, but holy men of God spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost. He said, for without faith, it is impossible to what? You've got to have faith. I heard it explained once as you've got to know what you know, you know, do know. Paul said something wonderful, and I really don't think we take it to the level we ought to. He said, I know my
Redeemer.
I know my Redeemer, what?
Liveth.
He was saying some awful strong words. He said, I know my Redeemer liveth. Because who was he at one time? And what a change he had come through. And when he said, I know my Redeemer liveth, he was saying it in a way that few men have ever said it. He knows his Redeemer liveth. Do you know your Redeemer liveth? Do you? Is your Redeemer's living by your determination or God's? Proverbs 3, verse 5, what does it tell us? Lean what?
On thine own understanding.
Mm-hmm. Have we ever thought about that? And what Paul truly meant by, I know my Redeemer liveth? How many of us believe we know our Redeemer liveth? How many of us? I do too. But do we know it the way we ought to know it? Do we know it to the depths and breaths that we ought to know it? The Mariana's Trench in the Pacific Ocean, I think, is said to be somewhere around 7.5 miles deep, somewhere close to that. Not exact numbers, but pretty close. How many of us in our relationship with God in the spiritual context of the Mariana's Trench is down at the bottom? How in depth is our knowledge of our Lord and our Savior, and how ought we to love Him? Should we not have Mariana's Trench love for the one who is completing the final atonement? Should we not? Do we have it? Don't answer that question here. Go home and think about it. I want to meditate. I meditate. I want it to germinate in you. Mm-hmm. Remember what Jeremiah said? He said to Jeremiah, he had what? Fire. Where? What did he mean when he said Jeremiah had fire in his bones? What was the most direct way that he brought it out? He knew something and he couldn't keep his mouth shut. He had to what?
The Spirit.
He had to witness it. He had to tell it. And he lived in a most difficult time where he was under constant threat, not only from the enemy on the outside, but the enemy on what? The inside. His worst enemies were supposed to be his best friends and closest advocates with the things of God. He saw his whole nation wrecked. He saw the outward manifestation and the prophestation, but up under there, what did they have covered up? They pretended like they were what? Or professed that they loved God. But up under those coverings and things in the temple, what was there? Huh? Loyalty to who? Satan. Loyalty to this present world. Not preparation for the kingdom to come. They definitely weren't ready for what? The final atonement. Let's look at Acts chapter 1, verse 2 through 11. Acts 1. Don't have a problem with getting me straight if you're necessary, because I don't want to walk around crooked. Acts chapter 1. Let's read it together. I guess I better get there along with everybody else. Acts of the Apostles, chapter 1, beginning with verse 2. Until the day in which he was taken up, after that, he, through the Holy Ghost, had given commandments unto the apostles whom he had chosen. We talked last night about part of it that he did himself, and the other part he commissioned to others. Did we not talk about that yesterday evening?
That's right.
Mm-hmm. Verse 3, to whom also he showed himself alive after his passion by many infallible proofs. God spoke to some tough folks. First bunch of people you would have thought that would have accepted and believed it would, had to be convinced. How many of us are still in various stages of being convinced? It says, by many infallible proofs, being seen of them for 40 days and speaking of the things pertaining to the kingdom of God, and being assembled together with them, commanded them that they should not depart from Jerusalem. If all of us don't learn a lesson from those 12 disciples and from a woman that had seven devils, and if all of us don't learn that lesson about who and what will be most loyal to you in the time of need, we might as well forget it. It says in verse 4, and being assembled together with them, commanded them that they should not depart from Jerusalem, but wait for the promise of the Father, which saith he, ye have heard of me. Sometimes waiting and being patient can be a trial, can it? Mm-hmm. In verse 5, for John truly baptized with water, but ye shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days since. And then you become like little Jeremiah's. You got fire in your bones and you can't keep your mouth shut. Isn't it wonderful of God? Give us a reason to do what we want to do anyway. Run that mouth. 6, when they therefore were come together, they asked of him, saying, Lord, wilt thou at this time restore again the kingdom to Israel? And this is important. And he said unto them, it is not for you to know the times or the seasons which the Father hath put in his own power. All the particulars about the final atonement, we don't have to grasp. But what we do have to grasp, this atonement is going on, and it's going on now, and it is for us. Some things are really not our concern. I know what I'm talking about before I tell you to turn back here. But I think it's in Numbers. If I'm right, oh, wait a minute, Deuteronomy. God meant for us to know certain things, right? Yeah. And it says what? Here we go, and I beg your pardon for that. Deuteronomy 29 and verse 29, the last verse. The secret things what? Do that sound a lot like what we just read? Mm-hmm. But those things which I revealed belong to what? Us. What's going on in the final atonement? Revelation. You get it? What's going on in the final atonement? Revelation. But those things which are revealed belong to us and to our children forever, that what? That we may do all the words what? Of this law. Of the inspiration behind what? This final atonement. But let's read a little further. But ye shall receive power. You're just not going to receive it when you want it and how you want it. But you will receive power that the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and in Samaria and unto the uttermost part of the earth. And when you get it, you ain't going to have to broadcast it. Everybody's going to know it. Huh? Everybody's going to know you got it. You ain't going to have to put up signs and neon and something. I got it. They're going to know you got it. Verse 9. And when he had spoken these things, while they beheld, he was taken up, and a cloud received him out of their sight. And while they looked steadfastly toward heaven as he went up, behold, two men stood by them in white apparel. But now let's go back to verse 9. And while they beheld, he was taken up. But what did he do before he was taken up? He commissioned them that what? Somebody's coming. And somebody is going to what? Put in you what you never had in you. You know what one of the reasons was God didn't take off immediately? Because them folks all around him wasn't ready yet. They weren't. They had to be made and prepared to be ready. Yes, they had spent many occasions and circumstances with him and saw all that they saw. But they weren't what? They weren't ready yet. I want you to search your heart. And I want me to search my heart. I don't want to tell you something I'm not willing to do myself. About us being ready. About us grasping the final atonement. About us shining light on darkness. In verse 10, and while they looked steadfastly toward heaven as he went up, behold, two men stood by them in white apparel, which also said, ye men of Galilee, why stand ye gazing up into heaven? The same Jesus which is taken up from you into heaven shall so come in like manner as ye have seen him go into heaven. How many of you have heard all the words I've spoken today before? But have they been heard in a context you never heard it before? Hopefully. That's what I'm doing. That's what I'm accomplishing. I can't tell you nothing new. And how many fellow pastors in here, ministers in here? Don't tell me there's none. We got some in here. And I'm telling you, for those of you that are in that ministry, how difficult is it to keep telling the same story over and over and over and over?
Jesus said, "We teach something old, something new."
Yeah. And the perspective is this: when you love to tell the story, it makes a great big difference. Does not the song say, "I love to tell the story"? 'Twill be your theme, even in what?
Glory.
To tell what? The old story of Jesus and his love. What is the old, what is going on now with the theme in this camp meeting? The final atonement is the old story. It's not brand new. And it is the old story of what and who? Of Jesus and his love. He's loving us like we cannot love himself, ourselves. He's loving us like we cannot love ourselves. But we need that love, don't we? Urgently and in depth, we need that love. Let's turn to Psalm 49:15. The book of Psalm in the Old Testament. But God will what? Redeem my soul from the power of the grave, for he shall receive me. What is our Lord and Savior doing? Although it mentions the grave, it's also speaking about us. What is he doing? What is the final atonement about? Redeeming. Being redeemed. What does the word redeem basically mean?
Buy
back. Because something is what? Been stolen or taken. And it needs to be purchased back. And that's what the final atonement is all about. He's buying us back. What was it when Moses sinned and Jesus came down? What was he doing? What was Jesus doing? He was redeeming him. He was buying him back because he was now the property of who?
Satan.
Mm-hmm. Let's look at Psalm 72, verse 14. He shall what? Redeem, Psalm 72, verse 14. He shall redeem their soul from what?
Deceit.
What have we been victimized by? He is called the great what?
Deceiver.
Mm-hmm. And the great what? Liar. And the murderer. Violence. And precious shall their blood be in his sight. He has to pay for that blood. Mm-hmm. Psalm 130 in verse 8. I hope y'all paying attention because quiet it is either that or y'all have gone to sleep too far that you will. Psalm 130 in verse 8. And he shall what?
Redeem.
Who is Israel?
Us.
How do we know that? What does that word mean? Actually, in a sense, what is it? It's not really one word, is it?
No.
Huh? Israel. What does that mean?
Prince of God.
What?
The Prince of God.
Okay. In the context for us, who are we?
Spiritual children.
Children. Of God. Mm-hmm. He shall redeem Israel or us from what? All our iniquities. There's some things that God just won't forgive. All our iniquities.
Amen.
How appreciative. How precious is that? All our iniquities. Because without that, what happens? Cessation of life, not only for this temporal world, but for the what? Kingdom to come. That's going to be the real trauma that's coming. It's not so fact. It's so much that if your soul is required, how it's required. It's the fact that it's required, and you're going to grasp how easily, in a manner of speaking, that you could have had it. How you gave it away so easily. The prize that has haunted man for thousands of years, made ready for in the final atonement. And there it was right before you. But we gave it away so easily. But if we choose, he is ready to redeem us. Jeremiah 15:21. And what does it say? And I will deliver thee out of the hand of who?
The wicked.
And I will
redeem thee
out of the hand of the trouble. How should that make you feel? I'm not saying how you genuinely feel, but it ought to be some joy. It ought to be some fire in your bones right now, knowing what God is doing for you in the final atonement now.
Amen.
There ought to be some rejoicing and some happiness. Who is the terrible?
Satan.
You being redeemed back from Satan. And you didn't pay the price. Only thing you can do is be the receptor of it.
Amen.
Does it bother some of us? We got to add our own little touch. We got to add our little contribution to redemption and restoration. Can we not just plainly accept it? Well, we're going to kind of finish it with Revelation 21, verses 4 and 5. Regeneration. What does it mean to regenerate?
Regenerate.
Huh? Okay. Or make new. Mm-hmm. Revelation chapter 21. verses 4 and 5. And what does it say? And God shall wipe away all tears from your eyes. You had any tears? Mm-hmm. Had any heartache? Have you had any sorrow? Have you had any grief? Have you had it to the point that the depths of it is just literally will make you sometimes shake? Have you had it? And it says, and there shall be what? Is there something to rejoice about?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Neither what? Sorrow. Nor crying, tired of tears. Neither shall there be what?
Pain.
Any more pain.
Amen.
For the former things are passed away. You ready for this to go?
Amen.
Hmm?
Amen.
Mm-hmm. Verse 5. And he that sat upon the throne said, behold, what? I make all things new. I regenerate.
Amen.
A new heaven and a new earth. Go back to verse 1. And I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For what? The first heaven and the first earth were passed away. And there was no more sea. I stood on the mountaintops and just saw the waves of the mountaintops and the beauty and the greenness, everything. And to me personally, it's beautiful. But I'm ready to let it go. Mm-hmm. Whatever I defined in my mind as beautiful and incredible and overwhelming, I'm ready to let it go.
Mm-hmm.
For what's coming. And he that, verse 5, and he that sat upon the throne said, behold, I make all things new. And he said unto me, write, for these words are true and faithful.
Amen.
Write them on your heart. Keep them steadfast. Hold on to them. In the United States Constitution, it says, we hold these things to be
self-evident.
We hold these things. In other words, it's something to hold on to, something to treasure, something to grasp and turn loose. And I'm telling you today, if you will listen to me, hold to the final atonement. Hold to the new heaven and new earth, the promise that's sure as we breathe air. That is so sure. Hold on to these things. The world will preach this and that and the other. And I know we think we've seen just absolutely the worst that men can do. No, we haven't. We haven't really even begun to approach what's coming. He told us there was a time coming that what? Such as never was before.
Mm-hmm.
It's not going to be in the tens or the hundreds. Maybe not even in the thousands. But the tens of thousands, possibly. Think about that. The hundreds of thousands. Something we have never seen before. He said it's coming, but when these things come, hold fast to what? That which is good. That which is God. Hold on to the fact that the atonement is being accomplished that delivers us from this present place to the kingdom to come. Hold on. To where I started. Go back to 1 Peter chapter 1. 1 Peter chapter 1. Hold on. Y'all excuse me. I have been bringing this book here for camp meetings for so many years, and everywhere else I've been in life, it's literally coming apart. It really is. It's just falling. It's just literally the pages, the whole thing. I wish you could see the cover. I've got to buy a new cover. I don't. My Bible is going to fall out somewhere, and I can't get it because it's going to fall in a bad place. That's how raggedy it is. But I have enjoyed this. I have enjoyed and loved wearing it out.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. And let's go back to where it says. Second Peter. I said it again, didn't I? I'm sorry. That's verse 19. We have also a more sure word. Let's read it together. We have also a more sure word of prophecy, whereunto ye do well that ye take heed, as unto a light that shineth in a dark place, until the day dawn, and the day star arise in your hearts, knowing this first, that no prophecy of the scripture is of any private interpretation, for the prophecy came not in old time by the will of man, but holy men of God spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost. Hold on to the lie that's coming that is not really true, because it is. Hold on to the fact there will be a new heaven and a new earth. And hold on to the fact that the final atonement is coming. And when the final atonement is accomplished, then look at what's coming next. Hold on. Thank you. I hope I've benefited your souls. Let's bow our heads. Father in heaven, thank you for the privilege and the opportunity. And every time I get to speak, it is a blessing and it's mercy for me. Not to hear my own voice, but it is a blessing that you would allow me, even in my present state, to speak a word that gives praise and honor to thy glory. We ask, dear Father, on behalf of each and every one, that you would hear our cry and that you would bless them in the multitude of ways that I cannot even imagine. But Lord, if you will, accomplish this, that we will appreciate and respect your son's sacrifice for us, not only what he has done, but what he's doing right now. And I ask you, if you will, to keep this steadfast in thy bosom and our bosoms of love and mercy. These things I ask for and I pray for in the name of your son, Jesus Christ. Let us say, Amen.